Okay. Folkets Park was, to those of you who don't know it, it was a park that for many years was like the activist park, the left-wing activist park. And you can see that the parents have built a playground of a specific form for their children because they wanted them to be raised in a socialist kind of thinking, maybe. So a lot of this was like self-initiated and built. This is at Nørrebro, and this is over here you have Stengade and Griffenfeldsgade, if anybody knows, and you have Nørrebrogade, it's like down here, like 500 meters down. And for many years, this park has been like this activist park and self-initiated. And at two points in time, the municipality wanted to sell off the square, the park, for social housing. But the residents resisted it totally civil obedience kind of way. So they changed themselves to the machinery and everything. And lots of riots and news, the press came, and you know, lots of these things happened. So they actually managed to defend the park and avoid that it was taken away as a green spot and into social housing. And then at some point in time, the municipality said, okay, it's going to be a green spot forever. So that is kind of the back history of the park. And then at some point they said, okay, let's also give it a makeover so that it's kind of nice and so on. And so they made this park, like, I guess it's about 10 years ago now that they finished it. It spent 13.5 million, and the 3.5 million was on this bridge, which everybody hated and didn't understand why the fuck they should have a bridge like that, coming from nowhere, ending nowhere, with no purpose at all. But actually it was, and they also made the park totally transparent, it was totally flat, all of these bushes and so on that was there before was taken away, so you couldn't have beer drinkers sitting behind, or drug addicts, or scary people, whatever. So it was totally transparent. But actually they had they said, because I met one of the architects from the process, saying that they had really an intense user involvement process for that park. And there was someone who wanted to have this metaphorical bridge in between this and that and them and us or whatever. And it was supposed to be, had two functions. One was that these small hilltops would be full of flowers and trees and bushes, so you'd actually walk along the, kind of in a foresty kind of situation when you walked on the bridge, but the plants never grew. And they also wanted to be a stage for concerts and performances and things like that. But then when the architect sent it on to the engineering security team for qualifications of the bridge, they put up this big metal fence, and then it couldn't be used for anything like a stage or anything. So it was totally dysfunctional, and people hated it. In the park you would have, you would have homeless people. There's a shelter for the homeless now there. At that point in time, where now it's for a different group, but at that time there was lots of African immigrants there. Before that, there has been other, ethnic Danish, mostly drug addicts and alcoholics there. But it was like, you know, socially marginalized people. And you would also have these young immigrant guys with the same face color as me, which would be in a gang and probably be criminal, probably sell hash and what have you, probably with guns. You see, they discovered that I took a photo of them. And they came over, and it almost went bad. It didn't, I mean, but because you just don't do that with these guys, at least at that point in time. But because when I took the picture, we'd been there for a while, I could kind of tell them who I was and why I took the picture. So everything was fine. But because of them, you also had the police there a lot. And you also had, parents. There's a small playground there. And you had parents, and they could also look like left wing activists, or autonomous groups, whatever. And you had this Folkets hus, the house of the people, which is like the castle. Well, castle is maybe the wrong word, but of the left wings in Copenhagen. So they had all these. It was like this self-organized house for left wing groupings. So a lot of people had always come there. A lot of people from Ruk, you know. But that, you know, so when there, I mean, normally the park was really, really empty. But when there was some event going on, when there was a critical mass of people, if there was like more than 10 or 20, then other people would dare to go into that park. Because normally, no one really dared to go into that park because of these brown young boys, men, coming there. And then you also had the spelt segment. I don't know if you what kind of expression you use out here, but also the cafe latte people or whatever. But they use, some of them use this spelt. It's like a flower, which is an old Nordic flower, which is kind of really modern and really like hipster kind of, I don't know, whatever. So anyway, it's just a way of saying normal people or regular people. So you had all of these different groups coming to that park. Or living around that park or using the park, because this segment of people didn't really use the park. That was the point. So at some point, there was a car who was attacked, assaulted by these young guys, immigrant guys. They were supposed to go to a concert. They were from Jutland, and they looked like they had very short hair, white, big, muscular, tattooed, and they were coming in this car, and then they were supposed to go to a rock concert in Forum, and instead they turned left into the park with these immigrant kids. So they thought it was the arriving gang coming, the Hells Angels or something. So they assaulted them in a really bad with knives and stuff. And then the municipality decided that we're going to spend 3.5 million Danish kroner on safety on this park. And my interpretation of that process was that a journalist, you had this assault, and then a journalist would call Frank Jensen, which the Lord Mayor, and say, you know, what is happening in your parks? What are you going to do about it? He was kind of say, he would look in his toolbox and say, okay, safety, there has to be more safety. That must be architecture. We're going to have more architecture in the park. We're going to have architects solve this problem with safety in the park. So they spent 3.5 million, which if we break it down, 1.5 million of that went into the administration in the municipality. So, and this is also a trick the politicians use both in local parliament, but also in the parliament. They tell the public that they're going to spend a lot of money, but actually a lot of those money are spent in the ministry or in the municipalities. So 1.5 million was spent internally, and then there was some money for our process, and then there were, which I'll get back to, and then there was like 1.6, 1.8 million was actually spent on building something. But what they did is that they decided to make, they made a plan with, I think it was 9 points, a safety plan for Nørrebro, for this Indre Nørrebro. The first one was architecture, and then it was user involvement, and these 2 points were the contract I got, where I hired Spectrum Architect to be part of that process. Then there was something about employment, and after 3 months' time, they decided we are already doing a lot about employment, so we don't have to do anything extraordinary about this. And then all the other points were about policing. So these things that, to me, and I think also to the staff in the municipality, obviously had, and especially residents, obviously had to do with social issues, had to be resolved mainly with architecture and police. Yeah, not going to say anything more about that. but then we made a contract with the municipality, and as this was the first project I've ever got, the first contract I have ever got to work for a municipality after being an artist for many years, I really considered how I could have a frame to work in that would still make it possible to make the kind of projects that I did. So I had just made this Inghav Mini Park project before, and I went on the summer holiday and they called me. This guy Henrik from the urban planning department called me and said, would you like to refurbish, renovate Folkets Park? And I said, yeah, that could be interesting. And I really didn't need the job. I had lots of things to do, which was a really fortunate situation when you want to negotiate something, that you don't need the job. When he called me, he said, you know, can you come up with 3 proposals for how you want to do this, 3 sketches? And I said, no, it's not how I work. We do a user involvement process, and then we'll come up with the right solution. Okay. But then this was in July, but we want to be finished before Christmas because of the budget years in the municipality. I said, no, that's not going to happen. I can't do that. It will take at least a year for a process like that. Okay. Well, he didn't want to say yes to that, but he said, okay, let's talk about that when you get back for holiday. I said, I just landed. I got a month's holiday now, so I can't talk to you now about this. So I had like 3.5 weeks on the beach with the pina coladas, thinking about how should I make a contract which would accommodate me as an artist in this situation of getting a contract with the municipality as an advisor. Because normally you have someone who pays the municipality, and then you as an advisor, you do whatever they say you should do. That's the normal way it works. And I couldn't work with that. So we made a contract which had different things put into it. And the first thing was actually the lawyer from the municipality who said we had to put that in. She said that the project will develop a new method for this context, and therefore the result cannot be defined beforehand. So it was method development. And that was because we knew that this was a gang territory and we couldn't really foresee that we would create safety or something like that. And the second thing was that we said that we wanted to be 100% integrity with everything we did, personally and professionally. So they could not ask us to do anything we didn't think was correct. That is totally unusual. You've never seen that in a contract with a municipality before. And we also said we are not taking on the contract out of commercial interest for the money. We are doing it to produce more community and love. And this is probably, and it's something I'm really proud of, probably the only contract with a municipality where it says that the aim is to create more love. But that was the frame created for us to be able to make something that was within the same, had the same kind of qualities as the art project I'd been making for 10, 15 years before that. And then when we came out to the local community, we started on doing the project. And actually, I just want to say that when we finished the contract, this was July when they called me, and when I got back in August, we started talking about the contract, and in February we signed the contract. So even their own system couldn't kind of handle, you know, doing it before Christmas. And they accepted the time frame also. So when we came to the local community, the first thing they said in this activist kind of environment, saying we don't want any smart architects or the municipality to come here and say what's going to happen in our park. So we are just totally rejected the first people we talked to. So we made this contract with them saying that we are only going to listen to you first before we are not coming with any plans or ideas or sketches before we have listened to you. So the first part of the project, of the process, would be to listen to you unprepared. And then we will, when we have understood your situation and your needs, we will use our professionalism to work with that. So we respect you. We don't have any skill. We respect you. We'll only listen first and get your needs and analysis into the process. But then you also have to respect us, and we translate that knowledge into something that would work professionally architecturally and so on, you also have to respect us. But with that, we can create a good result. And they accepted that, they kind of bought that idea, and especially when it came into action. So what we did was that we interviewed a lot of people. And we counted was maybe around 175 people in groups of 1, 3, or 5 people at the time in meetings of an hour and a half. And I always do these interviews in an hour and a half because when you have meetings in an hour, it's always the last 10 minutes or something that the good things come up. And so you need an hour and a half to actually kind of make something profound, have a profound discussion. And we also did this that when we planned the meeting, we had maybe 3 meetings in a day and we put an hour and a half between them so that we could first of all kind of absorb what we have heard of the interview, kind of correct our notes and so on, but also so that we would be in the neighborhood walking to the cafe or eating lunch or something, so that we would be visible in the community, that people would actually see that we are there, and we were in that way we would also be available for people to come up and say, oh, can you also talk to us, or I know we talked the other day but now I got this other idea, and you know, yeah. So that was really, but I'll get back to that also. So we talked to 175 people in person and in smaller meetings. And that's not really representative of there's maybe 3,000 people living around the park, and there's maybe 10,000 people that are, maybe much more, that are target group for that park that we are building. So how can that be, you know, democratic, which is something that the municipality is really concerned about. And we were also challenged with that. But the thing was that with that process of talking to people so profoundly, we got, and with all groups, that's also important to say, we talked to all groups that were there and wasn't there as well. That we got a really, really profound understanding of the needs and the situation in the park. So that was really crucial. So, but I'll get back to how we worked with that. So what we did after talking to all of these people and only listening, we made a report, needs and analysis report, and we sent that out to everybody. All the people we talked to, we sent that out by email. We put it on Facebook, different groups in the area and their own created, and we put it in the local newspaper. And we had this interest group. It's not from that meeting because I don't have photos of it, but we made an interest group of the follow group with the most important or most active people in the neighborhood. And we met them with them as well to kind of qualify the analysis we made. So it was totally transparent. Everybody could see what the analysis was and what we would stand on in terms of the rest of the process. Then we continued, and there's like 3 phases like this. So for the first thing was to ask about the needs and analysis. The next phase was to work on the conceptual drawings. And we did work on that. And we sent it out, showed it to people, email, Facebook, local newspaper, and so on. Different drawings of how the bridge would be transformed and so on. And we had another interest group meeting, follow-up group meeting, to talk about that. And then we made the finished drawings, kind of almost finished drawing, and we took another process with the same thing, local newspaper, Facebook, da-da-da, and the interest group meeting. So this was the kind of finished drawings, almost, and we had, this was from the interest group meeting. And this third interest group meeting, follow group meeting, was only took like 50 minutes or an hour. The other two have taken an hour and a half, because what happened is that they were like, you know, because we have been holding each other's hands all through the process, when we reached this point of the finished drawings, it was like, this is how it looked, you drew it, this is the way you went with that, okay, and now you placed it where we talked about it should be placed, and so on, because we already had agreed upon the analysis and the conceptual drawings and so on, they kind of knew where we are going. And this would be the point, actually, with these kind of drawings would be the point where you would normally presented for the public. So you see this totally different way of working, holding hands throughout the process. And then we made we built it, and the bridge, which was one of the points they were really, really hateful towards, and they just said, you know, we even thought about selling it as metal and see how much we can get from that. We also thought about giving it to a school next to the park, which needed a bridge, which actually needed a bridge. But at some point in time, the architect asked a really clever question, saying, okay, if you don't want the bridge, we'll tear it down. Don't worry. But let's say we keep the bridge. What could we use it for then? What could be the function of it? And with that, there was really a lot of new ideas that came up for how it could be used, and what kind of needs could be accommodated in this furniture. So in the end, we actually decided to keep it, but to transform it into a place where you could play, exercise, hang out, and also kind of do some performances on these steps or platforms. So there would be different needs that could be accommodated in this furniture. And also with these furniture, I mean, just to say this thing about when you ask about needs instead of asking about ideas, is that we had people saying that we have the need of sitting down. There were really a lack of furnitures, sitting down furnitures. We need to sit down with a backrest. We would like to lie down and sunbathe. We would like to lie down and sleep because we're homeless. We would like to play as a child. We would like to do parkour exercise kind of thing as an adult. We would like to sit in groups and individually and so on. So there were like maybe 7 needs that the architect could take and put into one furniture. They're all accommodated in this. All these 7 needs are accommodated in this furniture. So this is, and so it, so not only does it make you able to answer more needs, to fulfill the needs of people better if you ask them for needs instead of solutions, but you also are able to use the architects creatively. Because normally if you ask them for ideas, the users for ideas, and say, we want a swing, you can just order it on the internet. You don't really need the creativity of the architects, but by having needs there, you really use the architect in a really, really creative way, and they can create furnitures which you haven't seen before, like the bridge. This doesn't exist anywhere. We don't have any reference photo of such a furniture, but it came out of this idea of grouping needs and understanding the situation in the park. Lighting. In the park, we decided to do zone lighting because and when we did that, when we showed the municipality the drawings of the park and so on, they really, really argued that we need full lighting in the park because all analysis, all reports, all recommendations about preventive work, crime preventive work and safety in parks and so on shows that you need full lighting. But because of our user involvement, we have seen that there are 2 groups of people to whom lighting is not safety. That is the young immigrant kids who smoke hash or cigarettes, who doesn't want their parents or friends of their parents to see that they smoke. And the second group are the homeless, which to whom to sleep in a lit place is really, really dangerous. They would be discovered and people would piss on them and steal from them and so on. So it's much better for them to sleep in a place that is dark. So therefore we decided to do the zone lighting. And we really, really had to argue with the municipality. On this only, this was the only point we had to argue with the municipalities. But they, in the end, they respected the voice of the user involvement and had this zone lighting in the park. So this is like a kind of a illustration of the process. We had all these in-depth meetings. We had this meeting with the stakeholders, the follow group or the interest group, and we had these which I didn't talk so much about, but this bigger communal meeting where we, but we used that, though this is the form you normally have meetings in, where you have 30, 50, 40 people, whatever. But we use this meeting as more, which is what they're good for informing people. So what we did was that we had all these in-depth knowledge and we had the steering group, and then we could deliver an analysis. We could deliver something to this at these public meetings saying we understand the situation here like this, and we understand that there are these groups here, and we understand that this is what happens in the nighttime, this is what happens in the daytime, and so on. And then they could more like, instead of coming with ideas, which it would normally be asked for, they could kind of more say, that's correct, or that's not correct, or you also have to think about this and that. They could more qualify our analysis. But when we came with the analysis, which we can make, you can make an analysis in these type of meetings, but you can't do it here. And we also use the social media and bulletins and local newspapers and so on. And then you can go on to the next phase, and you could maybe, and as I talked about, also do more informal meetings. And we, because we also saw that there are a lot of people, you needed to talk to them more than one time. And we also, another thing, aspect is we also, which is something I've worked with over the years with Martin and I's group, you have to meet people on their terms. You can't ask gang members to come to a meeting, you know, or immigrants who need to collect bottles all day. You can't have a meeting with them. You have to meet them on their turf, in a way, and on their terms. So especially with the young guys, they were really like distrustful, I think is the right word, towards us. So we had to meet them several times, and we had to get someone to introduce us to the gang leader. He was actually the second gang leader, because the gang leader was in prison at that time, the LTF gang. So it really worked well to interview all those. And also, would also like to say that before we came into the project, the municipality had made short interviews with all kinds of group in around the park as a preparation for the work with the park, but not the immigrants, the homeless immigrants, and not the young guys. I mean, the two groups who are the main cause of insecurity, feeling of insecurity, they did not interview. And that is, as I said before, you know, problematic, but it's also because it's angst-provoking and it's difficult to talk to this group. But of course, we talked to this group as well. And we also discovered that they're not one group. We discovered that the young men were actually, if there were like 30 people, there would be maybe 7 who were part of the gang. There would be some who were not part of the gang, maybe were criminal anyway, in other ways. And there would be someone who had a job, and there would be someone who had an education but were unemployed. There would be someone, there was a guy who was an elite sportsman, and so on. So actually also we also had prejudice about that all these brown young men in the park were gang members and selling hash, but they were not. It was a really diverse group. And we also found out that there was only one who sold hash in the park, contrary to what all the residents thought, because there's only one guy who had the hash territory, and he only had one salesman who were allowed to sell in that park. So nobody else could sell in that park, were allowed to do that. And that knowledge we also put out there. We also put that in the local newspaper and so on to diversify the understanding of the group. So, and this is one of the point also, and one of the findings and discoveries or new methods developed in this project is that this idea of using the process for other means is just making a physical solution, just making architecture, because we found out that there were a lot of prejudices between different groups. Like, the Danish crowd, just to make it short, the Danish crowd, the spelt segment, were not really afraid of these African immigrants, but they were more afraid of these young brown men, they thought were gang members. But the Middle Eastern moms were really afraid of these African immigrants and thought they were really dangerous and so on. So there were all kinds of prejudices between the groups, and we found out that if we are going to get this park to work, we have to work with that. So we were kind of going from one to the other, kind of making conflict resolution and telling about, for instance, that they were not all gang members selling hash, was one thing we told them. And also at some point we wanted, it was a very masculine park, and we wanted to turn it into a more family-friendly park, because we didn't think we were going to go in that direction. But because of the young men saying that if you want to make, we were totally transparent about what the aim of the park was, that it should be more safe. And they were like taking that on, the young guys, and they said, okay, if you want a more safe park, you should invite families with kids. Then everybody will feel safe. And do that, and we think we should do that, and we will find somewhere else to smoke our hash, they said. And with that message, and also they also said that we really want this neighborhood to work well. We want to be good neighbors. We don't want anybody in our neighborhood, our neighbors, to be afraid of us. So with that, we could go to the other people and tell that. And the families could become more, they could begin to believe that it would be safe for them to come there with their kids. So in that way, we kind of work with prejudice and try to resolve conflicts between the groups. Another thing we also did, which is kind of what I dragged out of all my art project, was that to be that when we are doing the involvement and talking to the users, we should be part of the whole process from A to Z. Because when you deliver, I mean, normally you would hire someone, anthropologist or someone like you or whatever, to make a user involvement, then you make a report and you give it to the architects, then the architects look at it and say, oh, yeah. And then they would make something physically, and then they would give it to the contractors, and then they would say, okay, the architects want this, but this can't be built, and this is not good, and we'll build it like this. And then the users would come, and then they would say, what is this? What are we going to use this bridge for? Whatever, I don't know. We're just going to use it in this way. So you have all these handovers between the different groups normally, and a lot of things are lost in these handovers. So what we invented this method of that we need to be throughout the process. The one who understand the users and the needs and the analysis of users have to be part of the whole process. So this is what this is showing. So what we did in this process was that we, in the user involvement, we invited the architects to be part of certain points of the user involvement. We also invited the municipality to be part of the user involvement process. So we actually wrote that into the contract also, because if we were just doing the user involvement ourselves, and then come into the office of the municipality saying, the users say this, they would say, I don't know, you know. So in order to kind of get it under their skin, which is the whole idea, which is with the method in a way, you need to get it under your skin. You need to be there. So we invited the municipality also to be part of certain meetings, and also the architects. And then when the architects were, it was their process to draw, they invited us to be part of their process to qualify the drawings and see, okay, does that actually answer the need? Have you really understood the need correctly, or the analysis of the situation correctly, and so on. And also with the contractor, we could be part of that process as well and introduce the contractor to the local neighborhood and introduce the young immigrant kids to the contractor, so they knew that, you know, they wouldn't disturb the contractors and so on. But actually, I mean, this process wasn't necessary, because the contractor we hired was someone who were really familiar with the local neighborhood, Logik & Co. They're called Logik & Co. But also, and this is important as well, normally when you have architect urban space projects and so on, you have the mayor coming and cutting the thread here, and then you stop the project, everybody walks away, and then they start. But actually, you also need to work on how the physicality is used, and how you can work with the users. And especially with this situation with the Folkets Park, nobody who had made anything else than left-wing demos would use the park for events because it was a scary park with gangs. So we also worked on to get these event makers to use the park after it has been refurbished. And we talked a lot with people in the park about how they could use it and what the furniture could be used for. And also for the opening, we invited parkour people to come and perform on the furniture so that people could get the idea. You could also use it for performances, but also for parkour and so on. So, and also we had this big party as well, which, you know, you have at an opening. Where you kind of, I don't know if you, that translates into English, but you, in Danish there's an expression called you to subjectify users to a park, to a situation. I don't know if that works, but as a subject, you become part of it. And the thing is that if you come up here with me and we take a group picture of me, then I would be subjectified to the situation of being at RUC together with students here. And if you have a party in Folkets Park with families with kids, together with the gang members, together with the left-wing activists, together with the homeless people, all of these groups would be subjectified to the situation of being there together. So that is kind of something, a tool you can use to get people into the idea of that it can also be for them. Anyway, so one of the conclusions of many of the projects that I've done over the years is that when you make something a space, you cannot think only about the physicality of it. It's not enough. You also have to think about community building. You also have to think about how people are going to work together or function together in this park. And you have to work on that. You can find yourself having to solve conflicts, having to lay down prejudice. And you can also use the process to create transparency towards the needs of particular groups, so that you understand that maybe I have this needs and I think the park should be like this, but there are also other groups that have other needs and they should also be accommodated, that you kind of create transparency between the different needs of different people. But there's also social issues sometimes, not always, and this is really hard. You can't really, I mean, we couldn't solve crime, gangs, unemployment, drug use, hash use, and so on. We couldn't solve that, of course, in that project. But what we could do, and which is what we did, is that we addressed it. And we wrote a report saying that we find all these social issues here in the park, and if you want it to really work, you have to solve that. And we send that report on to the municipality to work on. I don't know what they did about it, but not much, I think. And also this thing I mentioned about the use, you also have to secure the use of the park. The people understand how it's used, and you have to invite people in to use the park. So all of these layers is something that you also have to consider when you make a physical renewal. There could be other layers. Maybe you can come up with more. So, that was the last one.
It's wonderful to get those projects laid out with this detail and get a sense of the process over the stretches of time. So we do have some minutes for questions or discussion.
As I said before, think about, you know, what do you think about the projects, the approaches, the methods and so on. I mean, what are your opinions? What do you think?
I really liked it. It's also because before in our lecture, one of our professors mentioned about the West Park, and I actually live very close to the West Park. And I didn't know about the story that there were like drug users, so they created like colorful lights and lighting on the bench so they couldn't actually sit there and inject like blue light. Then that day, when I went home, I was thinking like, oh, I don't really feel good about the project because it didn't solve any social problems. It just push the marginalized people somewhere else, dark space in Copenhagen. So in a way, like, I don't know who actually initiated the project, but I see like one big difference with that one and this one. And yeah, it sounds very interesting. Thanks. Although I agree with this view, at the same time I'm still questioning. It looks super successful, but first, I mean, the effects in 5 years' time, is it going to last or is it going to change, like, what will happen? That's one of the concerns that I have, and another one is, in each case, we are relocating some people who are marginalized. Like, in one case, the grants are relocated to somewhere else, and in this case, okay, people say voluntarily, like, in my family, they will go smoke hash elsewhere, but then they will smoke this hash somewhere in Copenhagen again. I mean, are we really solving it, or are we also still moving people around?
No, I think I expressed that wrongly. I mean, nobody went elsewhere to smoke the hash. I mean, what they said was more that they were kind of fine corners within the park. Where they could do that so that the families wouldn't discover it or kind of do a bit more hidden. They would stay in the park, they are still in the park. And also with the beer drink, I mean, they had to be moved because they were turned down the square. They had to be moved somewhere else. But the project was about that nobody took care of it and that we tried to find a place to accommodate these people. So we were actually inviting them in to a square, to a place. But just to say also that, I mean, both of the projects, I don't know which one you were referring to, but if it's a public party, and with this party, they're both initiated and financed by the municipality. But with this project, they were more daring, and they were more kind of concerned with user involvement because it was a really difficult situation. So they were willing to pay for a process of user involvement that were more profound. And the benefits also came out of that, but it was a totally different project that they've done. And also this method, which is totally usual that you use strategic design to make it good for middle class people and not marginalized people. And they find it really successful if all the beer drinkers and drug addicts and homeless people disappear. I said, look, they're not there anymore. You know, it's like, that's really successful for many, many planners. But it is like this. It's just like creating problem for them in the worst way. And what they don't realize is that the marginalized people are always the ones who feel most insecure or unsafe. We don't realize that. We think that they are, because we are afraid of them, we think that they feel really safe, these homeless drug addicts. But they don't. They don't feel like shit in the public space because they don't have nowhere to be. They have no legitimacy. They can never claim a space. So just pushing them away makes them even more marginalized and unsafe. And so on.
You said something about the stormlight, the municipality to get it approved due to it being saying yes to the hash in the dark.
Well, yeah, I mean.
Is there something about, what about the other ones that were? Yes, represented.
Were they
okay by saying yes to
that?
I know it's then a bit more controlled because you know
they're
there.
Mm. And, so. I mean, as a history is back to that, because when we made the contract with the municipality, we said beforehand we will not throw anybody out. We will not throw anybody out of the contract, out of the park. Mm. We wrote it in a way that we said we will work with all groups and include them in the project, no matter their legal status. That's how we formulated it. So anyway, we looked each other's eyes and said we're not going to do a project where we're going to push them away. And the police also, I mean the municipality, one of the departments we work with knew about that. Also, that the police thought that they were happy about. Strange to say, but they were happy about people saying has in this part and not pushing it away. It was such a small sale that they didn't really care about it. I mean, of course, sometimes they caught them, but there was like a between municipality and police, there was like an understanding that that it's happening in this part, you say, okay, we don't want to push it somewhere else where it's going to happen in places where we less want it. So you had that beforehand. So when we said that the zone lighting is also for the people smoking and for the homeless people that are also submitted towards that, then they, you know, they. But it wasn't that we just made it for them.
No.
We just also included them. We made it for everybody else. It was a more greater feeling of safety in the park because there was much more lighting than beforehand. It was totally dark beforehand. So we made lighting on the pathway and along the building in the nighttime. So there was much more lighting and it was much, you could overview it better and you could, because and you had a pathway through the park, which you didn't have before, which was lit. It was a way where everybody got their needs fulfilled.
I was wondering about your reflections on community building, because the two cases seem like maybe one's more successful at the end than the other, perhaps. Because one of the things I noticed is that the community of beer drinkers is kind of more, it's a community of beer drinkers that dominates the space, or the other, well, this park is much more contested space still. So I was wondering how you think about this kind of contested space of community building. How do you see that now? Do you think is a problem, or is it possible, or are you optimistic about those projects?
I think it was a really successful activity in the Folkets Park to bridge, better than the physical bridge, the bridge between different groups by telling them what the others thought and what needs they had and what their feelings were towards the other group, and that we should all live together. That actually when we talked to them, everybody wanted to be friendly towards each other and had good intentions, and by telling that to others, and they also seen it in action, because it worked out. Also, as you asked about how it worked out in the future.
She's gone.
But it worked out in the way that many more families came there, and it became a really, really attractive playground, this transformed bridge. So you had much more people coming and being there as family. So you actually, they very quickly, fortunately enough, saw that, okay, now it can also be a park for families. So we managed to create a critical mass of people coming there so that people felt more safe there very quickly. And also these event makers began to make events there. So you saw that now things are happening there. So by all of these things, you kind of created a feeling of community, even though they didn't sit maybe in the same room discussing issues. They have heard of each other's, and they experienced being there together much more after. And I think also to your question about how long does it last? Because when you work with a group, smaller group, with great involvement, of course, they disappear over time and new people come in. How does that work? And that's a challenge for this method, I think. But I think that the atmosphere of how something was created is kind of last, and it kind of survives and is told on by others, or you have a feeling of that it's, I don't know, somehow there's some energy when it's made with the users that is different from something that is top down. So I think that, especially with Folkets Park, that it has become more resilient. This is a new buzzword in urban planning. I'm sure you heard about it. Towards gang wars and so on. Because when we were there, there had just been a gang war that had stopped. And when we were working in peacetime, everything was happy-go-lucky. And when our project started, when we finished making it, there was no gang wars, and people just took the park on. But then there came another gang war, the recent one. And then what I experienced is that one day I was there, there was like 30 LTF gang members on Bilgos Plads, which is just next to it. And there were three police cars and so on. At the same time, I saw two families playing in the park on the furniture on the bridge. So I think that the understanding of the community and that the gangs were not shit going on. That the gangs were not targeting families and so on, that this understanding would make people feel more safe by coming there now. Not that we can say that people will surely come there even though there's gang war going on, that's not going to happen. But I think it has become more resilient because you understand that everybody wants community and a good neighborhood. But that's, you should go there yourself and experience how it works.
That's just funny because that sense of energy that the process creates, I can see how that's continued in the more so than the book. But maybe that has something to do with the ownership they take, that they give continually and get back continually, whereas the ownership isn't clear in the Folkets part. So it kind of, I mean, I live around the corner, and for me it seems like there was an initial burst of energy, but it seems like it peters out, and I don't know, it's not your impression, but it doesn't seem to be used as much as it was 3 years ago, 4 years ago. And if maybe it had something to do with that connection with ownership and place, and well, I'm interested why I don't know how you navigate that.
I mean, you try to do your best. I mean, you can't solve all problems in the world, but I think that the park is more inclusive and more inviting, and there's more to do there. That was also like a basic problem before. You had nothing to do. You couldn't even sit there. So there's much more reasons to come there now. And also, which we haven't talked about, the cafe of the Folkets also had, we talked a lot with them about how they could address people, the public, more in a more open way, not just addressing. You know, before it was, you kind of had to know that there was a cafe there and you were actually invited to go there. But they put out like A signs and furniture outside in different ways to kind of signalize that this is a public cafe, stuff like that. So I think that it's there's a lot of physical solution also that points towards if you are invited.
We're going to have to end because of the time. But
I'm going to write for another 3 questions.
Should we take them all 3 together or something? Should we do that?
I can't do that. I'm not.
No,
let's
okay.
Take one at a time.
Okay.
I don't know if you were first.
Just do these 3.
I was wondering, as an artist, how did you place yourself in this such holistic group of like 3 firms of architects and with the municipality, the user groups, all this? Social researchers as well. So how did you feel in this group? Like, what was your role actually?
Yeah, I think that, I mean, I've done several kind of public space projects before that. So at least that setting was, I was used to that, and also working with different professions. But now this was more like a contractual kind of ordered project and not my own project with art money where I could do whatever I wanted. I had a customer that I had to satisfy, kind of. But I think that, so the crucial point for me in a way was to have this contract where we really went through what was the frame. What I said to them was, if you want me to do the project, the type of project that I've done before with success, in your frame, we have to make a contract that accommodates that, that make room for that, that frames that. And so that was the work we had to do. And I think, so it was really, really fortunate for me to be able to go through that process, and they were willing to do that. And they really wanted me to do that. They didn't think they could find anybody else who would talk to drug addicts and homeless and gang members and so on. But also, it is the field that I'm interested in, the field I'm working in as an artist, and I'm thinking of it as that I'm inviting people into this art space. I mean, it's a formal art space that I'm saying that now, this is an art project. I'm trying to say that it's not always that they subscribe to it, but I'm saying this is an art project, and for me, we can do whatever we want. We don't have to limit ourselves to this and that. And one of the aspects of, I mean, the reason why something like that can come out of a process like that is because I don't only look at architecture or social work or carpentry. I look at everything, and I'm so unskilled in any of these fields that I have to invent it new as new because I don't know how to do it correctly. So what I do is that I'm really attentive. I'm really present. I have to be because I don't know shit. So I really have to think and use my intellect and my skills and whatever to see, okay, in this situation, what should we do here? And then I use, of course, the people around me with their professions to say, okay, we have to, maybe this, maybe that, maybe this. And then I can invent ways of doing it that works well. But I think that one of the problem as a professional is that you often, you become really, really skilled, you know, in one field, that you're not skilled to look at other fields, and you're blind in a way to different fields, and you, this is a problem we have, and that's why you could also call it interdisciplinary. I mean, this was a buzzword at this school, like, I don't know, 10, 15 years ago. Everything has to be interdisciplinary. We don't talk about that anymore. But in a way, it's really, really crucial if you want to create profound solutions that works on all levels. So I feel great.
Yeah, I mean, no, it's just interesting because this would be my definition of a designer, and it's interesting that you define yourself as an artist that and play with this blurred picture of what is an artist, and to be the one that is gathering all the other actors and being like the one leading the concept. So it's almost branding of your ideas and everything more than. The manager. But it's very. I like the term artist because it's not related at all to this consumption-based creation. It's based on something.
Yeah. I mean, also like the idea with the benches in the Folkets park that because as an artist, I mean, as a designer and an architect, you work very much with form. Whereas as an artist, you always also work with content, symbolic content. What should it mean? So with these furnitures, for me, when people come and see them and sit there, I hope that they will not only see a form and see it's a nice design, but they will also see the team that made this. Listen to me, they included me in the process, they also talked to the other people in the park, and they created a form that worked well with for everybody and so on. So they would also see the content of creating unity and community and friendship and good neighborhood and so on, that they will see that content as well. I don't know how far that goes, but it's an aspect of when I work with bodies. You know, the space that I think also is different from architects and designers. They're more, I mean, it's not that they, I mean, it's not black and white. I mean, architects and designers and artists wrap over in many cases, but there are some aspects of it that are different where we can use each other different ways.
Two more questions and then we will have
or comments or ideas. Yeah?
Yeah, I was wondering how you would say how much the location of these two projects influenced the outcome, because I was thinking that, like you also said, in Vesterbro maybe it's more socially accepted that there are beer drinkers on the street, and Nørrebro is also very more cultural, and maybe you have people that are more open towards different people, different kinds of people. So how would you approach maybe a project like this in a different neighborhood where maybe it's not that diverse and where people have maybe more prejudices even than, in Nørrebro maybe, for example?
Yeah.
That has an influence, or?
It has a really great influence. Yeah. I mean, for me, when you have this model of art, of an artwork where you talk about form and content, I have developed that. I've expanded that model further, it's in the book as well, where you also have context and discourse and process as part of that model. If you want to understand these type of artworks, you also have to understand the context. So to your question, it's part of the, you cannot understand this without understanding the context. So it's so crucial. And that's also part of the method in these projects is to understand the context and to take that in as part of the element of how you want to solve it. So it's really, really crucial.
But do you
cannot, and that's also just to say that when you need to solve a problem, there are kind of two main ways of doing it, to my knowledge, when you talk about open space. You could use best practice. So you look at an example, somewhere else have done something, and then you take that, say it's a really good solution, it worked there, let's use that here. The other way is to develop a method specifically for that situation, for that context. And that's, it's, of course, it's obvious that it's the latter method I use. I develop a method specifically for that context, for that situation, because that makes sense to me. The other one doesn't. It doesn't really address the issue. So for me also, I think, as a general suggestion is that we should make much less public spaces and projects, but make them better and make them more context related. Because I think they would be so much more successful than just trying to do as many public spaces as we can. And many of them, to my opinion, are not totally, but often partly unsuccessful. Because you don't understand the context. You don't relate to the context and the uses and the specific needs and the situation that is going on there. So it's really crucial. Really good question. Yeah.
Did you want to come back?
No, it's okay.
I'm just wondering what the municipality thinks about the results. Are they happy?
We have a film about the project where we interview the guy who ordered us to build it, who was our main contact, Ivan, and he answers that to some extent in the film. The thing is that, I mean, I think they were really happy about it, and it's been really successful, and it's got good reviews, and even after, I think a couple of years after, there was one from, they have a section in Politiken and a newspaper where someone has to choose their favorite place in Copenhagen, and one of them suggested Folkets Park. Because of the diversity of people that would be there and so on. But I think that they were, I think they were really happy about it. I think they found it one of their more successful projects, and even the Lord Mayor and the Mayor of the Technical Department who opened the park were also really happy about it afterwards. So I think in general they were really, and I've talked to lots of other municipality people afterwards, especially in these they have these regeneration projects where they take an area like Sydhavn or Vesterbro or Nørrebro, like this area, and then they make a regeneration program. I'm sure you would hear about this in your studies here. But these organization 5-year projects, a lot of them has approached me and consulted me and used my project as a reference project and so on, because they think that Folkets Park was really successful. And also there was a regeneration project on Balfelt just after we finished, and we could kind of, I mean, all the mistrust that was there before, we kind of worked with that so that the trust towards the municipalities became much greater with our project. We saw that very concretely that some of the people who didn't want to work with us in the beginning actually was willing to work with the municipality of this regeneration project after we went away. So we kind of had bridged that. And they also said that they took over an area where they were really open-minded and happy to get involved and so on after our project. So I think that, I mean, of course I would always say that when you ask me, but I think that the municipality in general has really looked at this project as a way of doing it. At least have taken picking methods from, I've learned that.
Thank you.
I'm proud.
Thank you so much. It's also, I mentioned the website earlier, but as Kenneth mentioned, a lot of these really interesting films about some of the projects and a lot of other material up there, so do follow that up. It's been really valuable to hear about the process and the methods, but also getting a sense of how these projects work over time. So thank you so much for coming.